What I put in my body matters now more than ever. As a parent, I'm always reminded of that and to go beyond in everything that I do.
In December of 2016, the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics published a review of the evidence for the safety and benefits of vegan and vegetarian diets. They concluded that appropriately planned vegetarian, including vegan, diets are healthful, nutritionally adequate, and may provide health benefits in the prevention and treatment of certain diseases. These diets are appropriate for all stages of the life cycle, including pregnancy, lactation, infancy, childhood, adolescence, older adulthood, and for athletes. This statement has been a focal point for many of those who advocate for a plant-based diet. While at first glance this paper appears to present a good argument for vegetarian and vegan diets, when digging deeper into the claims the study makes, it is clear that the authors did a poor job of drawing conclusions based on the current research. Before carefully reading everything through, I briefly skimmed the article to see what points they would be making, and was stunned to find an entire section dedicated to discussing why these diets are better for the environment. Why would they include something like that in a paper that's supposed to be looking at the nutritional aspects of plant-based eating? I thought that the authors might have had a reason to do this. Perhaps they were already advocates for this way of eating before writing the paper? I checked the potential conflicts of interest, to which the authors reported there was none. Then I looked up the authors, and it started to make sense. Visanto Molina became an ethical vegan after learning about the animal cruelty of factory farming. Since then, she has published 12 different books about vegan and vegetarian diets and was sponsored by the Dietitians of Canada to speak to different groups of dietitians about plant-based eating. On her YouTube channel, which has less subscribers than our own, you can find her speaking about how to save the environment by not eating animal foods. Surely, she was unbiased in her review of the scientific literature when she wrote this paper. The next author, Winston Craig, is a Seventh-day Adventist, a religion which requires those who follow it to abstain from eating animals. He also taught chemistry at 3 Seventh-day Adventist schools. Of course, he has authored multiple vegetarian-focused books as well, which certainly benefited from the public statement that he issued. The final author, Susan Levin, began a vegan diet nearly 18 years ago. Why did she start? I'll give you a hint. It wasn't because she thoroughly researched the nutritional adequacy of the diet. Susan was also paid to promote a fake meat brand, which thankfully no longer exists. So let's just keep in mind the agenda in place here when considering this so-called research.
You are fake news.
Let me begin by saying that I believe that it is totally possible to be nutritionally complete with a vegetarian diet, especially a pescatarian diet that includes fish. My stance on veganism is different. I think that it is pretty clear that without supplementation, a vegan diet can be very problematic. Even with supplementation, there are still clear risks, as there may be differences from the nutrients found in food and the form found in supplements. The paper is largely about potential nutrients of concern on these diets and why those who do decide to do them shouldn't worry. First, they discuss protein. They state, vegetarian, including vegan, diets typically meet or exceed recommended protein intakes when caloric intakes are adequate. In the reference study they list, they specifically state that vegetarians do not get as much protein as non-vegetarians. This study found that vegans get even less protein than vegetarians, and they also have a lower caloric intake. This is important to consider because the authors made it clear that it is possible to get enough protein so long as energy requirements are met. In actuality, it is much harder to obtain protein from plant sources because of the volume of food needed to meet protein needs. The authors then state that including a variety of plant-based proteins will supply all of the essential amino acids necessary, and that the regular use of soy and legumes will help meet these needs.
People eat them, apparently.
Oh, really?
While this is true, this is only one piece of the puzzle when it comes to protein quality. We must also consider compounds such as protease inhibitors, which reduces the bioavailability of the protein. In the previously mentioned citation, protein quality was determined using the protein digestibility corrected amino acid score, which does not take into account these factors. However, it wasn't their fault. That paper came out in 2005. The FAO didn't recommend using the new protein quality score, the digestible indispensable amino acid score, or DIAS, which does take into account bioavailability, until 2013. It just begs the question, why cite a paper written before the new score was introduced when the new information was available when this review was written? Probably because it would expose their frail argument. When we actually look at the DIAS rating for different foods, it becomes clear that animal foods are superior when it comes to protein. Next, they discuss the omega-3 fatty acids EPA and DHA. These are completely absent from a vegan diet without supplementation. They do admit that vegetarians do have significantly lower blood levels of these fatty acids, but claim that the evidence is unclear whether this has any negative health implications in vegetarians and vegans. Notice the wording here, claiming that there is no evidence in the plant-based population. This is important because studies have pretty consistently found that lower levels of blood omega-3 fatty acids are risks for certain cardiovascular conditions, and that higher levels are protective. However, since these studies were not done specifically in the vegetarian or vegan populations, they can state that the evidence is inconclusive. They then go on to state that vegetarian and vegan children do not appear to experience impairment in visual or mental development, a dubious claim to say the least. Their evidence for this claim comes from two studies, neither of which even mention vegetarian or vegan children. However, one does mention an important point, that the levels of DHA in breast milk is significantly lower in vegetarians and vegans. One trial showed that children fed a formula devoid of DHA had poorer visual and cognitive development compared to children fed formula with DHA and children who were breastfed, the mothers being omnivores. This is very important to note because the authors specifically stated that vegan diets were safe for pregnant and lactating mothers. It's also pretty much universally accepted that DHA is important for neurological development, and the research suggests that DHA deficiency as a child can worsen cognitive development. However, again, since there have been no studies specifically on vegan or vegetarian children, and I know this because not even the authors could cite one, they can state this and appear to make a good point. In fact, we should be more concerned about vegan children's cognition, since not only will they lack essential fatty acids, but other nutrients like vitamin B12 and zinc. Next, they tackle iron. Iron can be a problem on a plant-based diet because of the low bioavailability of free iron versus the highly absorbable heme iron, the latter only found in animal foods. They do admit that vegetarians and vegans tend to have lower serum ferritin levels, a blood marker for iron status, yet try to spin this as some kind of advantage, claiming lower serum ferritin levels may be an advantage because elevated serum ferritin levels have been independently associated with the risk of developing metabolic syndrome. While this is true,
your argument is utterly ridiculous.
Sure, high serum ferritin is bad, but they casually gloss over the issues of iron deficiency without anemia, such as joint pain, fatigue, and even migraines. Iron deficiency is significantly more common in those excluding meat from the diet. They then go on to downplay the importance of heme iron in the diet because of an adaptation in vegans and vegetarians that increases non-heme iron absorption. The study they listed did show a 40% increase in iron absorption in the group eating a low heme iron diet over the 10 weeks. What they conveniently didn't mention was that this was still 4 times lower than the amount of iron absorbed by those in the high heme iron group. This is probably one of the reasons that those on a plant-based diet consistently have been shown to have lower levels of serum ferritin than those who include meat. They also ignore studies like this that show heme iron being necessary to replenish low iron stores, or ones like this which show that non-heme iron absorption is more than 3 times worse on a vegetarian diet. One more point about iron is that vitamin B2, riboflavin, is necessary for our body's absorption and utilization of it. It has been shown that riboflavin deficiency decreases absorption of iron in the intestine. Once absorbed, riboflavin is also necessary to properly use iron, since it converts iron into a form that is physiologically useful for humans. They don't even mention riboflavin in this review at all, but it is relevant for vegans, approximately 30% of which are riboflavin deficient compared to 10% of vegetarians and omnivores. They go through several other nutrients such as calcium, vitamin D, and B12, and essentially admit that these will be lacking on a plant-based diet and recommend supplements. While actually, there was one study showing how vegans can avoid B12 deficiency without supplementing.
This calendar studied vegan volunteers who had vitamin B12 deficiency disease characterized by megaloblastic anemia. She collected 24-hour stools, made water extracts of them, and fed the extracts to the patients, thereby curing their vitamin B12 deficiency. Okay? So they're eating shit.
Now, while I'm not entirely against supplements, there are several issues with relying on them for such a large amount of essential nutrients. The first being the form of the vitamin that you get. Are you getting B12 in the form of cyanocobalamin, which is synthetic and less absorbable from the vitamin? Or are you getting the much more bioavailable methylcobalamin? Are you getting B9 as the inferior folic acid, which actually inhibits the body's ability to bind true vitamin B9 methylfolate? There are also synergies between nutrients, such as that between vitamin A, D, and K to form bone tissue. Then there's nutrients that have opposite effects, where a balance of them is necessary, such as magnesium and calcium. Unless you are well-versed in the research on essential nutrients and the different forms found in supplements, supplementing properly can be very difficult to navigate. There also may be nutrients that we are yet to discover, or compounds we haven't yet classified as essential. I mean, we didn't even know that choline was essential until the late 90s, when hospitalized children were getting fatty liver disease because they weren't fed choline. My point is, supplements can certainly be helpful, but the complexity of nutrients is yet to be fully understood, which is why getting everything you need from food is always your best bet. It's very unlikely that we can simply look at what nutrients we don't get in our diet, swallow some pills, and assume that everything is optimal. At the end of the day, how can we say that a diet that requires 5, 10, or even more nutrients to come in the form of supplements is good for everyone? The review also neglects several other nutrients that will be lacking on a plant-based diet. Take vitamin A, for example. While the precursor form of vitamin A, beta-carotene, is abundant in plant food, it must be converted to active vitamin A, retinol. This conversion depends on what food the beta-carotene is in, what food you eat with it, genetics, amongst other things. Retinol is only found in animal foods, so you're basically gambling on being a good converter by excluding them from the diet. Another nutrient missing from this paper is vitamin K2, which again is absent from plant foods, besides some fermented foods like sauerkraut and natto. These foods are absolutely essential to get in on a vegan diet, or else there will be no K2 in the diet whatsoever. However, the type of vitamin K2 found in fermented plant foods, MK7, is only one form of the vitamin. MK4 is the form most abundantly used in the body and is only in animal foods like dairy products, animal fat, and egg yolks. We can convert K1, the vitamin K in non-fermented plant foods, into MK4, but the conversion appears to be pretty inefficient. This 2017 systematic review compared supplementation trials of vitamin K1 and K2 and found that K1 supplementation did not produce the effects of K2. Such as increasing bone density and preventing cardiovascular calcification. There are also several nutrients exclusive to animal foods that are considered conditionally essential. That means our bodies can produce them, but often only in amounts that are necessary for survival, not for optimal health. These include carnitine, carnosine, creatine, taurine, and cholesterol. All of these compounds have been shown to have positive health benefits, and it is possible to become deficient in all of them. Something that vegans will be more at risk for since they are absent from a vegan diet. Overall, I find the paper to be incredibly disingenuous and biased. There is a clear agenda in place, evidenced by the fact that all of the authors are ethical vegans and the exclusion of multiple pieces of evidence to go against their arguments. The agenda isn't only being perpetrated by the authors of this paper, but the entire Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics is an all-powerful cabal of corporate corruption. The Academy has been trading favors for cash with various pharmaceutical and food companies for decades. In our next video, we're going to take a deep dive into the truth about the lobbying and shady business practices of these conglomerates. Suggesting a vegan diet is suitable for all ages and populations is dangerous, and that is mainly because most people that do a vegan diet are not well educated on how to supplement properly. Most vegans are not people who actually research what the diet lacks and the dangers of poorly constructing one, since veganism has always been more of a social and ethical movement than a diet meant to nourish a human being. Unfortunately, this has led to tragedies of infant death because of a diet that they didn't even agree to. Even if you do understand how to supplement properly, are you really going to risk your child's development and possibly even their life because of an ethical belief? Do your own research, don't appeal to the so-called experts who are only out for their own financial gain. Please give us a like if you enjoyed the video. Don't let them fool you. Subscribe to our channel.